court. So today I'm happy that I can welcome an expert on crystalline silicon technology in the Netherlands, Dr. Arthur Weber. He accepted the invitation to join this course. He is the leader of the crystalline silicon solar cell technology at ECN. ECN is the Energy Centrum Nederland in Dutch, so Dutch Energy Center.
Energy Research Center. In detail.
Well, I think that you introduce ECN.
Yeah.
And as I mentioned to you earlier, crystalline silicon solar cell technology is at the moment the dominant solar cell technology. So when you want to buy a solar cell module, then probably you will get something like this. And how these solar cells are made, so this is this unit, how we put them in modules, this will be now the topic of the lecture that Arthur Weber.
Okay, thank you, Miro. Here you can see an outline of my presentation. So first, indeed, a general introduction of ECN. Then I will focus on ECN solar energy, what we are doing. Then some general aspects on silicon solar cells. You probably know it already from the previous lectures. And then I'm going to look in detail in crystalline silicon photovoltaics. I start with the feedstock, so the raw silicon material, then the wafering. So that are the substrates for the solar cells. Then the silicon solar cell processing, so really how you make from raw silicon material, from the silicon wafer to the cell. Then some module technologies and also the new developments. And finally some cost analysis and environmental analysis. And in the end, the summary. So first of all, ECN. It's in Petten, so far north. It's almost the end of the world, so it's near and helder. Here you can see the Isle of Texel. We are in the dunes, and there are several companies on that side. ECN is one of them. NRG is the nuclear department, or let's say nuclear daughter of ECN, and also KEMA. But I think ECN took over all the shares, so now it's a full daughter of ECN. JRC, that's a joint research center. That's a European research institute. And it's the owner of the nuclear reactor, the research reactor there. And Covirion, used to be Tyco in the past, that's for radio pharmaceutics. So they're making all kinds of isotopes. They use a nuclear reactor for that, but also here some cyclotrons. First of all, the target of ECN. We do research for transition to renewable energy supply, and therefore it's important to improve the efficiency of the renewables, also develop new technologies for that, and another part is of course the clean use of fossil fuels. So it's not only renewables but also, let's say, energy saving, and we're aiming for maximum reliability, maximum environmental burden, and of course optimal cost effectiveness, which is easier nowadays than, let's say, a few years ago with let's say a $120 oil price per barrel. We have several program units. One is a strategical one. It's policy studies, so really desk studies. What should we do? Should we use wind? Should we use solar? Should we use a mixture or biomass? Or just burn all the oil? A department on energy saving. So that's, for example, they're looking in detail the energy efficiency used in industry, so improving all kinds of processes there. A unit, renewable energy in a built environment, so they're looking at architecture, but also how to apply new technologies in buildings, or, for example, it can be photovoltaics on roofs, but also using all kinds of new technologies for energy supply or smart energy use. So, for example, how you should use your light and all that kind of things. three groups working on renewable energy. Now, solar energy is one of them, so that's why I'm working. Wind energy, of course. And then we have something like biomass and environmental research. Yeah, coal is mentioned in it because, let's say, when you look at how you can burn biomass, it's really related to coal, so we're doing some coal research as well, and then it should be to the energy, in the area of energy saving. And then we have clean use of fossil fuels. That's hydrogen and clean fossil technology. And a supporting unit for the engineering and services. So, a workshop. Now to solar energy. We have three main topics. One of them is silicon photovoltaics. The other one is the thin film technology. So, for example, amorphous silicon, microcrystalline silicon, organic-based silicon. And the PV module technology. And our objective is that the price of solar electricity should be, let's say, the same as the consumer electricity price, and that should be in 2015, and then in the Netherlands, so not in Southern Europe. And after that, of course, even lower. And we're aiming for high efficiencies, reduction of material use, because material is really a cost factor. And of course, the cost effectiveness and environmental friendly processes should be developed, and also the products. And a long lifetime of the PV modules. So the lifetime nowadays, the guarantee is about 20 years, and we're aiming for 30 years. Why are we working on all these technology? Some people say you have different generations of solar PV modules. One generation is crystalline silicon, so it's the oldest one. The second generation is the thin film technology. And the third generation is called, let's say, the organic-based PV technology. But we see that as technology families. So we have three technology families. And for crystalline silicon solar cells, you can define different generations. And here you can see, for example, the module efficiency versus the cost. So here was the status, let's say, in 2004. And in 2010, the prices should be lower. And even in 2030, yeah, we don't know what the PV technology will be then. But you can see low price and high efficiency. Yeah, from this graph, you should say, okay, here we have crystalline silicon PV, and here the thin film modules. So thin film modules are cheaper per watt peak. But this is only the module price, so it's not the total system price. Of course, you have to mount the modules on your roof, so you need cables, inverters, from DC outputs to AC output. And when you include that, then the price for the different technology is more or less the same. So the watt peak price for the modules is different, but the kilowatt hour price, so the real output of the whole system, is more or less similar, and it's independent on the technology you use. At least at this moment, and it's expected that in the future it will depend on application which technology will be the cheapest one. And cheapest, I mean kilowatt hours. So here you can see some examples of technologies. For the thin film technology, we're doing research on sensitized oxide. So it's a titanium oxide base, so toothpaste, latex paint, that's the material. But we apply a dye. And that's the active material. There, the photons are absorbed and converted into electricity. And an electrolyte is used, and everything will be encapsulated. So here you can see the cross-section of that kind of solar cell. And here you can see the real solar cell and a module. It's a smaller module. And our efficiency gain, our efficiency goal is about 8% in 2015 on 10 by 10 square centimeter. And the device should, the lifetime should be longer than 10 years, outdoor stability. And then the real organic solar cells, it's a solid state version. So here you can see all kinds of different organic compounds. And also, our objectives are the same as for the dye-sensitized solar cell. So this research is, for example, related to the OLED technology, the organic light emitting diodes. A thin film technology, another one, is the so-called thin film silicon technology. Silicon, it's the second abundant material on Earth. So we're, this is a main topic of our research. And our technology is the so-called roll-to-roll deposition. So here we have a pilot machine, and we grow the silicon solar cells really in a continuous way. So we have a stainless steel substrate, and on that the thin film silicon substrates are deposited. And actually we are aiming for a so-called microcrystalline silicon solar cell, and on top of that an amorphous silicon solar cell, so a multi-junction solar cell. And the efficiency should be 12%, and here you can see the price, and that in 2015. We're doing something on PV systems as well. It's a minor activity. So we are looking into interaction with the grid PV modules. You can imagine when you connect, for example, 1 gigawatt or 1 megawatt, now start with several megawatts, into the grid, that you will see all kinds of problems. And they were indeed, you could see them. So it's not straightforward to connect several megawatts to the grid. You really have to take some precautions. System design and monitoring is also important, and also some standards and guidelines, for example, safety. Okay, now crystalline silicon PV technology. The objectives are the same as for the whole unit. So high efficiency, reduction of the material usage, cost effectiveness, and long lifetimes. And when you look at the high efficiency, our aim is 18% on module efficiency. And that with module efficiency, I really mean the full area efficiency of the module. So not only looking at the solar cells, but really the edges are taken into account as well. Reduction of the material use, the wafer thickness, so the silicon substrates you can see there. Now, okay, this is an old module, and the thickness of the solar cells in that module is around 300 micrometers. Nowadays, 200 micrometer thickness is used, and we're aiming for less than 150. And then you should think about 100 or maybe even less. And the energy payback time, so that's when you look at all the energy that's needed to make a module. And then, the energy generation, and when you divide it to, you have something like an energy payback time that should be less than 1 year in the future. And I will come later on to the current data. So here you can see the cell structure of a crystalline silicon solar cell. When you look in detail, it's a so-called minority carrier device. So not like all the diodes or all the other electronic compounds. Most of them are majority carrier defines. We're looking at the minority carriers. So here you can see a cross-section of the solar cell. When light is falling on the solar cell, electron hole pairs are generated. And we use a P-type base, so that means that the electrons are the minority carriers. And those are important for the current generation in the solar cell. So here you can see again, we start with a borium-doped silicon substrate, P-type material. We apply a thin emitter on it, so we add phosphorus and we diffuse that into the silicon in the solar cell. So you have a very thin N-type layer on top of that. And when you look at the losses in the solar cell, they are occurring in the base of the material, so the bulk of the material, but also on the top of the layer. And the voltage of the solar cell is generated over the junction. Of course, we have to apply metallization, because you want to get the current out of it. But then you have shading losses, but also resistance losses. We apply an anti-reflection coating, so that's the blue color, because silicon looks like silver. And that enhances the current, so you have more output out of the solar cell. And what really important is, especially when you go to thinner cells, are the surfaces. The surface, you can see that as an end of the crystal. And there, a lot of losses occur. And therefore, we apply all kinds of layers to reduce that. Once again, the solar cell. But here you can see the band structure. So here you have the N-type emitter and the P-type base. So light, a photon is falling onto the solar cell. So it generates an electron hole pair. What you want to prevent is that you have recombination. So this electron should be collected. So it should diffuse to the emitter and then really will be swept over the PN junction into the emitter. And we have something in the end, at the end of the back surface of the solar cell. We apply aluminum at the rear side, and therefore we have some additional doping there. So this will act as a kind of a mirror in the energy band structure. And this is called the back surface field. So you see an energy barrier. So this prevents the electrons going to the rear side and there to recombine there. This is one of the tricks applied in the standard silicon solar cells. So here you can see the back surface field. It's a highly doped layer, we call it P+, and it reduces the recombination at the rear surface. Another loss mechanism in the solar cell is the so-called color mismatch and some fundamental losses, and therefore the efficiency is below 30% in a standard single junction solar cell. Here you can see another kind of bent structure of the silicon solar cell. So here you have the valence band and here the conduction band. The color mismatch is, for example, when the energy of the photon is not enough to go over the band gap. So that's for the infrared or far infrared light. There's only one wavelength that perfectly fits with the band gap. But when you have higher energy, then you have also some heat losses. And these losses combined with this over the whole spectrum is called a color mismatch. And there are some additional recombination losses when you have impurities or defects or surfaces in the solar cell, imperfect crystal structures, something like that, then you have enhanced recombination as well there. So therefore you really need pure material. Of course the shading of the metallization is one of the losses. Reflection, absorption, transmission, especially when you have absorption really at the rear side of the solar cell, resistance losses, and of course non-ideal band gap. That has to do with also when you have highly doped layers or all kinds of defects. And for crystalline silicon solar cells, the efficiency is between 13% and 20% in general. Of course, there are cells that are not that good, but there are also a lot of cells that are better. You can see characterization. It's also very important for a solar cell. For a standard solar cell, it's just the diode characteristic, nothing more and nothing less. It's shifted and swapped, the symmetry, it's swapped over the x-axis. So normally a diode curve looks like this. We always, in the solar cell world, plot it like this, and then it's shifted upwards for the total current. But you can read these kind of characteristics of the solar cell. So the ideal one is the blue one. And when you have some serious resistance losses, you can see that it looks like the purple one. So you can see an angle here. And when you have shunt, it will be at the other side. So when you read these IV curves, you can already see something for the losses of the solar cell, so where you have some problems. And of course you can measure the open circuit voltage, so this is this one, the short circuit current, so that's the current at VOC zero, and of course here you have something like the maximum power point that's needed for the efficiency. And how the curve looks like, you can already see some losses, resistance losses for example. Another thing that's very important for characterization of the solar cells is the so-called internal quantum efficiency. And that's when you have That's the collected carriers over the absorbed photons. So that means how many photons are really converted to electrons and collected. Since silicon absorbs, let's say, the real ultraviolet light at the front surface or near the front surface, and the red in the bulk, with this technique you can make a cross-section of the quality of the solar cell. So here you can see an example of the internal quantum efficiency. So here you can see the lower wavelength light, and here, let's say, the longer wavelength. And here you can see the quality of the front side and the emitter. And here you can see the quality of the bulk of the material and the rear side. So for example, for the red light. And at the very end, above 1,000 nanometers, above one micrometer, you can see say something on the reflection of the solar cell. So when you have all these kind of techniques, you can really measure the quality of the solar cell, and also depth dependent. So then you know where to improve your process. Okay, now how we're going to make the solar cell. So first, I want to say something about the feedstock and the effect of impurities on the cell output. Then something about wafers. Here you can see a class of wafer materials, the so-called monocrystalline material. So it's a single crystal material. All the atoms are regularly ordered, a long-range order. And most of the solar cells look like this, so-called semi-square silicon. For the multicrystalline material, you have all kinds of pieces of single crystal material. So here you have some grain boundaries, as they're called. And then the solar cells look like this. And here you can see an example as well. You can see different pieces, different structures in each solar cell, and that are the individual grains. And of course, you have recombination losses at all the grain boundaries and where there are impurities. Then I will say something about high efficiency processing with industrial processing. Then a module technology. We are aiming for a so-called integrated design of the cell and a module. So use simple interconnection and encapsulation technologies. And then something about the cost and environmental aspects. So first of all, how can we make the feedstock material? You start, for example, with quartz and carbon, the silicon oxide and carbon material. From that, you can make silicon. It's so-called metallurgical grade silicon. And that's only 2 nines, so they cannot be used for solar cells. Then you have all kinds of refining technologies, and then you can end up with so-called electronic grade silicon. And that can be used for the semiconductor industry. In the past, the PV world uses, let's say, the material that was not used by the semiconductor industry, which was produced additionally. But nowadays, the PV world is even bigger than the semiconductor world, so we really need our own silicon. And there are several ways to make the so-called solar-grade silicon. We don't need the quality of the electronic-grade silicon material, but what we really need, we don't know yet. So we have to do some research and development for our own, making our own silicon. So here you can see the different process routes that are under development. One is a direct conversion of quartz and carbon into solar-grade silicon. Some people are working on the conversion, a simple purification of the metallurgical-grade silicon, and some, after refining the material, also doing some research. The goal is to make the solar-grade silicon as cheap as possible and should be good enough. So we don't need the really high quality, but it should be good enough. ECN is working with partners on the so-called direct conversion of quartz and carbon. It's a so-called SolSilk process. So in a plasma furnace, we convert the silicon oxide and the pure quartz material into silicon carbide. And with silicon oxide again, it's converted into liquid silicon. So here you can see an arc furnace here with all the material, and silicon, liquid silicon is extracted from that, from the bottom. And when you want to look at the quality of the silicon you made, so you start again with molten silicon, you have to make silicon wafers again, or silicon polysilicon rocks. So you melt the material, and then with a heat exchanger, you solidify a block of silicon. And yeah, the size is something 60 centimeters, something more nowadays. And this whole ingot, as it's called, is about 300 kilogram nowadays. Some people are using smaller blocks, that's, let's say, 240, so it's this size, this height. And some are already working with larger blocks. So here you can see an ingot. And here you can see, in general, how the impurities are distributed over the ingot. You can see a different color at the bottom and also at the top. And there, in that areas, there are a lot of impurities. And also really small grains. For example, here you have, on the bottom, you have contamination and impurities from the crucible. And on the top, you have all kinds of material, for example, iron. Because of the segregation coefficient, so iron wants to stay in the liquid instead of in the in the solid, you have some accumulation there as well. There are also other impurities, for example, oxygen is also from the crucible. Crucible is mainly quartz, high purity quartz. So when the oxygen concentration decreases from the bottom to the top, and the dopant concentration, for example, boron, or when you use other material, N-type-based phosphorus, that increases from the bottom to the top. The metal impurities, there's a highly contaminated layer at the bottom, and then you have some decrease. But in general, when you look all over the ingot, you can see some increase in metal concentration going from, let's say, not the real bottom, but let's say 1 or 2 centimeters from the bottom to the top of the material. Then you will sort this material, and they can make a wafer out of it, and they can make a solar cell. And when you look at the output, and when you add some impurities in the feedstock material, you can see the effect of the impurities on the output. And that's needed to define the so-called solar-grade silicon. So for example, here you can see the output of a very old study. So it's in the 80s, so with technology in the 80s, PV. Here you can see the effect of impurities on the cell output. So here you can see the relative output, and here the concentration of impurities. So you can see, in general, you can see when there is an increase in impurities, then the efficiency will decrease. So here you have tantalum, molybdenum, and all that kind of materials. Here you have chromium and iron, nickel, aluminum, and here phosphorus and copper. And when you look at, let's say, the feedstock material, where you have, let's say, a higher level of impurities, in the ingot, because of the segregation coefficient, so that means that iron wants to be in the liquid and not in the solid, then in the ingot, the effective concentration, the concentration will be much lower. And due to some segregation, it will increase into the top. So when you know, for all the elements, these kinds of plots, you can define the impurity level required for the solar-grade silicon. So here you can see, for example, for aluminum. So that means this curve. So when you can accept, let's say, 2% reduction in efficiency, you know where the concentration should be in the ingot. With this calculation, you know the initial concentration at the, let's say, the bottom part of the ingot. And with this, you can calculate the effect on the concentration in the feedstock, in the raw material. So in the real world, it looks like this. We add impurities, in this case, titanium and oxide or combinations of that, to the feedstock. We process silicon solar cells. Here you can see the position in the ingot. So here the bottom and here the top. In blue, you can see the so-called standard reference, the clean reference. And here you can see the results of material made from feedstock where you add some impurities. So with this, you can see really the effect of impurities on the cell output. You can really see a decrease, and also dependent on the position in the ingot. For example, in red, you can see titanium with some oxygen, and green, you can see the effect of some titanium and also iron and carbon. We even made a model of this. So first we start with impurities added to the feedstock material, then we grow the ingot, then we make a wafering, do the wafering, cell processing, characterization. And for the model development, we estimated that the diffusion length, one over the diffusion length square, so that means the diffusion length of the electrons in the base material, so that's proportional to 1/tau, the lifetime. That's really, and we assume that that's proportional to the impurity concentration. We know that we have segregation during the ingot growth. And then with solar cell modeling, we can estimate the efficiency of the solar cell with this relation. There are simple computer models for that, or not that simple, but okay, simple to use computer models for that. And so we know with that we can calculate the efficiency dependent on the lifetime of the material. So that means dependent on the concentration of the material. So you can make something like this, a relative cell output versus, for example, titanium oxidation concentration or concentration of other impurities. And here you can see real data points on that for titanium and probably iron as well. And here you can see also some data on N-type material. Here you can see our data, but also data from all the studies, of this plot of the 80s. So some are falling on that, so the so-called Westinghouse studies, and some not. And here you can see two curves. So we did a study with, let's say, at that moment, the process of the silicon solar cells was, for example, for the standard industrial process was just below 15%. And also relative for our record cell, 70%. And you can see that the relative efficiency decrease dependent on, for example, titanium oxide is the same. And we have curves like this. So the relative efficiency versus the impurity concentration. And when you have some results, when you add 5 ppm aluminum or 10 ppm titanium to the feedstock, and then the efficiency is around 75% of the standard one. With this plot, you know that when you reduce the concentrations by a factor of 60, something like that, you end up with a high efficiency, which is only a few percent lower than the standard one. So when you do these kind of studies for all kinds of impurities, you really can define solar-grade silicon. And we did the studies for titanium, aluminum, iron, molybdenum, and chromium is nowadays under investigation. So with this, we can really define the so-called solar-grade silicon. Of course, when you have the feedstock, you have to make wafers out of it. And here you can see the different technologies. Here you can see the pooling of single crystals, the so-called Sokolsky technique. So then you have the round wafers. You know them from the semiconductor world. Expensive, but higher quality. And also you can see some plots of really casting multicrystalline material, so-called block casting. You can see just a jar, let's say, a crucible with silicon, liquid silicon in it, cast it, and solidification, and then you have the block. You can also use the so-called Bridgman solidification. Then here you have some heaters, and when you pull down the crucible, you have a well-controlled solidification from the bottom, or use a heat sink. Then you can crystallize it as well. But then you still have blocks and you have to saw the wafers. Now there are new technologies, so-called ribbon technologies, where you don't have to saw the wafer. So you're really pulling out a ribbon, a wafer, out of the liquid silicon. Something like here. Or a technique I will show you later, the so-called ribbon growth on substrate. This is where ECN is working on. Or a development company that's a daughter of ECN. So here again you can see the plot from silicon melt up to the ingot growth. And then you section the ingot, and with the wire saw you can make the wafers. So this is for the multicrystalline material, but also the wire saws are used for monocrystalline material. So when you look at the monocrystalline material and the multi again, the mono material is high quality. That means low impurity concentration, of course low defect concentration, and you obtain high efficiencies. So in industry, it's between 15% and 70% cell efficiency, and piloting, or let's say special industrial processing efficiencies, over 20% are obtained. But the cell costs are higher than for the multicrystalline material. But, yeah, there's a higher impurity concentration, more defects, and therefore you obtain a lower efficiency, let's say between 13 and 15 plus. And on pilot, you can obtain already over 16%. And lower cost per cell. But the module cost per watt peak, or per kilowatt hour, are similar. However, for both techniques, you have to saw the wafers. And especially when you go to thinner and thinner wafers, you throw away half of the silicon. And when you know that silicon is more than 50% of the cell cost, or of the module cost, it's really a stupid thing. So you have expensive material, you throw half of it away, so you have to think for the future, you really have to think of new ways of making the silicon. And that's indeed the so-called ribbon technology. So for example, here you can see the so-called string ribbon material. You have the crucible, and in yellow, the liquid silicon. You have some wire material, and then you're putting out the silicon. And the wafer is grown between the wires. Or you can grow an octagon. So it's called the edge-defined film fed growth technique. And it's made by Schott Solar. You have to keep in mind that the substrate growing and the crystallization are in the same direction. So you're really pulling out the material in this way. So the growth direction and the pulling direction are the same. For ECN's ribbon technology, or it was first developed by Bayer in the past and took over by ECN a long time ago, we use a different technique. So here you can see a casting frame with liquid silicon in it, and then you're pulling out the substrate underneath that casting frame. So the pulling direction is in this direction. You're pulling a liquid film, and the crystallization direction is in the other direction. So they're perpendicular to each other. And with that, you can make solar cells at a much higher throughput. So here you can see, when you do it in a continuous way, so you have a belt and a casting frame. So with this you can make silicon wafers with about one wafer a second, while the other techniques you read minutes and minutes. And here you can see some silicon substrates that look like wafers, standard wafers like here. So for ribbons, you have a better use of the silicon material. It's about a factor of 2. The disadvantage is that the initial material quality is even lower than for the standard multicrystalline material. And therefore you obtain somewhat lower efficiencies. But it's still under investigation. For EFG and string ribbon material, the efficiencies in industry are around 14%, sometimes close to 15% already. And for RGS, it's still earlier in the development chain, the efficiency is still 13% on the lab, but very high throughput. Here you can see some figures from 2001 for EFG. For example, when you have a 100 megawatt factory, you can see the pulling speed is around 2 centimeters per minute, while for RGS it's 600 centimeters a minute. So when you look at the square centimeters per minute output, you can see there is more than an order of difference. And when you look at the number of furnaces you need for, let's say, 100 megawatt factory, which is already a small one nowadays, for EFG you need 100 furnaces. For string ribbon, at that time, more than 1,000. Nowadays, the technology is improved, and yeah, you need a few hundred, but still more than EFG. And for RGS, you can do with 2 or 3 machines, only that. So some new figures on RGS. The cell efficiency, cell efficiency in the lab, the average efficiency is still 12.5%. The best efficiency is 13%. And when you use a high solar cell efficiency process, so really the most advanced process you can think of, then it's 14.4%. It also made a 100 micrometer thin RGS ribbon. Here you can see a picture. 111 micrometer thin. We only made a few ribbons, so that means we could not optimize the process, so it was just a lucky shot, and we obtained an efficiency around 11%. And although this efficiency is lower than here, and also the material is not as good as it can be, it's already less than 3 gram silicon needed per watt peak output. And when you look at the standard modules, so more advanced than these modules, that's still 3 gram per watt peak. So you reduce with this technique already a factor of 3 in silicon use. And when you keep in mind that the module costs are determined for 50% by the silicon base material, you can really see that this technique will be the technique of the future of these kind of techniques. Okay, now the cell processing. So we have a wafer. At ECM we can start with most of the time we start with a wafer we bought, so this wafer sort from a large ingot, because there's not enough RGS material available at ECN, still in development. We have to remove the saw damage, and we use a single wet chemical step, and with that we can already make a rough surface, a so-called textured surface, so that will enhance the light coupling into the cell, and then you obtain better efficiencies. Then a phosphorus layer is applied and diffused into the wafer, and during that diffusion also the material quality improves. Then we apply the blue layer, a silicon nitride layer, and that's a magic layer. There's some hydrogen in that silicon nitride layer, and during further processing hydrogen diffuses into the material, and that will improve the efficiency even more. And also it's a very good capping layer of the silicon solar cell, so that you reduce the recombination losses at the surface. So it has 3 functions. Anti-reflection coating is one, and the so-called bulk passivation, so hydrogenation of the bulk material to improve the material quality, higher output. And also it's a good capping layer for the solar cell to reduce the losses at the surfaces. Then metallization. We use silver on the front side, aluminum in the rear, and then you also obtain a so-called back surface field, so the mirror at the rear side to reduce the recombination. Yeah, and then of course everything will be so-called sintered, so we have a so-called firing step in a furnace. Yeah, why it's called firing? When you look at the metallization, there are different compounds in it, and we also organic compounds, and you really have a small fire in your processing furnace. So it's really fun when you look at it. Here you can see one of the classes of processing, batch processing. So you have wafers in carriers, for example like this. And here you can see the different process stations, for example etching, junction formation, so the diffusion of the phosphorus, the anti-reflection coating and the contacts. And when you use batch processing, you can have very defined process, very controlled processes. And when you go into the lab and you want to make the highest efficiency as possible, then it's better to use these kind of processes. But the disadvantage is that you really have to load, unload and transport the wafers. Our idea is in-line processing. That means wafer in, solar cell out, and you have the wafers on a belt. And here you can see the different process stations. So it's a different philosophy. so you don't have to use carriers anymore. And especially for large, thin and fragile wafers, they are easier to handle. You only have to put them in on belt, wafer in, cell out. So don't load and unload and all kind of carriers. So there will be less wafer breakage, and therefore you will end up with high cost. And here you can see examples of the batch processing, for example at BP Solar, the so-called Saturn line, it's near Madrid. Here you can see wafers with carriers, and here you can see the different process stations. And here you can see the inline processing. It's available now at Solland, in the southern part of the Netherlands, in Heerlen. So here you can see really horizontal furnaces, where you have wafer in and in the end cell out. You have clusters of process stations, so you have some loading and unloading, but it's only at, let's say, only at two places in the whole production line. Now, our processing at ECN, our so-called baseline processing, we start with multicrystalline p-type material, then we apply an acidic etch texture to remove the soil damage, but also making the surfaces rough to improve the light coupling, and we use wet chemical bath for that. Here you can see a picture of it. Then a diffusion, and we use a belt furnace, really with a metal belt, so impurities are diffusing from the belt into the silicon, but we have some tricks to prevent that or to overcome that. Then a deposition of silicon nitride, metallization, and then simultaneous firing or contact sintering, and we use a belt furnace of this. Here you can see our old small lead belt furnace still working. And our efficiency is, the average efficiency is 16%, and in industry it's 15+, so we are somewhat better. And now the individual process steps. First we start with the acidic texturing. Here you can see a wafer with an alkaline etching. It's really shining, and here you can see it's more gray. So it's a wafer with a rough surface, it's textured. And here you can see our system. It's also inline horizontal processing of our wet chemical station. And here I have a more detailed picture. Here you have the inlet. Here you can see the etching bath, rinsing, so it's cleaning with water, some destaining, that means an alkaline treatment, where you can remove, let's say, the black parts, oxidize on the silicon, water again, drying, and here you have the outlet. And we use an HNO3 mixture for that. Here you can see the appearance of the solar cell. So here the traditional one, so-called alkaline etch with a high reflectivity, also after coating, and here the acidic textured with anti-reflection coating. And efficiency gain using this process with respect to that one is 0.5% absolute. So you're going from, let's say, 15.5 to 16%. And the cells look better, they're black. I have some examples here. For monocrystalline silicon, you can use an alkaline etching to texture the wafers, and then you end up with so-called pyramids. Especially when you etch the so-called when you have 1-0-0 substrates, because alkaline can have some preferential etching. It's a so-called anisotropic etching, and the 1-1-1 planes have the slowest etching rate, and therefore, after etching, you will only obtain 1-1-1 planes, and therefore, and then you can see a structure like this. And this is the best, one of the best textured structures. For multicrystalline material, yeah, you don't have only 1-1-1, 1-0-0 directions. You have all kind of, it's a random material. Then you cannot use the alkaline etching, so you need something else. And therefore, we use the HFNF3 mixture, and then you have a random structure like here. It's an isotropic etching. Yeah, maybe it's good to have a break now.